We're very close to the end. We're almost done with our application. But at this moment, our program has a big problem that we haven't mentioned yet. If when I'm playing a game, I input anything other than an integer as an answer, I get an error and my application breaks. And that's because I didn't implement any validation. I'm allowing the users of this program to input anything for an answer. And that shouldn't be the case. In any application, I need to control what the users can input. And that's both for security, but also to provide a better user experience. So let's see how we're going to implement validation in our answers. I'm going to create a while loop where I'm going to check if the string is null or empty. So if the answer is empty, the loop will run again. And for that, I use the isNullOrEmpty method from the string class, passing the result. And I'm also going to check if the input string can be passed into an integer. So I'm using the two vertical lines, which is the OR operator. That means that I'm checking for one out of the two conditions. To check if my input can be passed into an integer, I use the int32.tryPass method, passing the result and the output variable. And since we don't need an output, we just use the underline. And we could use the pass method of the int32 class, but the difference is that the pass method crashes the application if the input can't be passed, and that would require more advanced techniques to handle this error. And inside the code block, we're going to display a message telling the user what happened. So we're going to say that the input needs to be an integer and collect the input one more time by calling the console.readLine method. And we shouldn't forget to use the exclamation mark in front of the tryPass method, because I'm checking if the input won't be passed to run the loop again. The exclamation mark returns the opposite result of the Boolean expression. So let's test if the validation works. I'm gonna play a game and try to input a string as an answer. And it works. And since I'm gonna use that same validation for all the games, I'm going to outsource it into a new method, which is going to live in the helpers class. So I'm going to call the helpers.validateResult method, which hasn't been created yet, and use Visual Studio's refactoring tool to create that method. And then I'm going to grab that loop and take it to the validateResult method. And we need to return a string since we have that in our method signature. So let's run the app and see if it works. If I input a string, it shows me the message. And if I input an empty answer, it also shows me the message. So the next step is to call that method from within all the games. Once that's done, let's deal with something else. At the moment, I'm allowed to input an empty name when my app first runs, and I don't want to allow that. So I'm going to keep the program just as the starting point of the app, and I'm going to move the getName method to the helpers class. So I have to make it internal and static, so it can be accessed without instantiating the class. But I'll also add validation so that I'm presented with a message if the name is empty. So let's test if it works, and it works fine. And the last step will be a small fix in the menu class. First, we're going to clear the console after we input the name, and then we're going to prompt an input before we show the menu. Because at the moment, the initial hello message is presented, but the console is immediately cleared, so the message can't be seen. So we're telling the user to press any key and using the console.readLine method. And if we run the app, now we can actually see the welcome message. And before we publish this app, let's remove the filters from the printGames method, and let's clear the list of games because we don't want to start with any game in our list. So now it's time to publish the app. We've already learned how to do that in the beginning of the series, but let's do it again together. I'm choosing the option Publish Selection from the Build menu, and I'm going to choose to publish my program in a folder of my choice. So I'm going to create a new folder as if this computer was being used by someone else. And I'm going to pretend that I'm creating this game for my sister. So I'm creating a folder called My Sister's Folder. Once that's done, let's click on Finish, Close, and then Publish. And if I find my sisters folder in the Files Explorer, I can click on the application file, which is an executable, to run my game. And let's play it one time to make sure that everything works fine. And the game works along with the history. And that's it. That's the end of the first part of this course, but I'll give you a challenge before you jump into the next part. I want you to try to create difficulty levels for our games. So when I choose a new game, I'll be presented with a menu where I can choose to play an easy, medium, or difficult game. And that will have to be reflected on our games list. So when we print our game's history, one of the items for each game will be the difficulty level. It will be challenging, but you've learned everything you need to implement this functionality. Feel free to submit your code for me to assess, and I'll be happy to have a look. And of course, stay tuned for the next part of this course, where we're going to build the same game now as a desktop application.